We're going to start, I think, at the beginning with Black audio, but can you start, John, by telling me, I know you've studied sociology, how did you find your way into working with images and sound?
Liz, I can't thank you enough for this. This woman badgered and twisted my arm. I was extremely reluctant to do this, but she thought there was something in it, so I hope there is something in it. So thank you. Thanks. I studied sociology, then really cultural studies, I suppose, to be, between 79 and 80. Sorry, what am I talking about? Yeah, 79 and 82, I think. But I've, in a way, been involved with filmmaking all my life. I mean, I had a Super 8 camera, which my mother bought us when I was, I think, about 11, 12. So I've always made stuff. And I belong to a sort of film group at school. But the... And I'm really glad this guy's here today, actually. The guy who really got me thinking systematically and formally about film was... or is, rather, a man called John Digens, who's here, who's just sitting over there. I can't believe he still looks the same. And John ran the first of, I think, a small group of film studies classes. As was it an O-level or...?
Initially
O-level. Right. And I joined his class at City and East London College in the late 70s, 77. And we studied, you know, genre, auteur theory, I mean, all kinds of words I didn't even understand at the time. But it was a useful and interesting way of beginning to think that there was something else to do with cinema other than just try and make Charlie Chaplin and Super 8, you know. Mm-hmm. It was the first time I actually thought, hang on, there's something there. And it was an interesting moment because the nucleus of the collective that I then belonged to from 81, 2 onwards were also at the same college. So I met 3 other people, 2 of whom were also kind of in and out of this film studies class, Risa Geist and Lena Gopal, at the same time. So that's in a way how it started, in that very convoluted way in which things always start, you know, mix of being involved with something informally and then getting the chance to think that there might be formal, ethical, political questions raised by that interest when you get involved with it in a more structured way. So that's kind of how it started.
Well, I think why don't we look at a clip from the early Black audio stuff and then talk a bit about the politics and the motivations behind it. So we'll look at the first. So this is a clip from the early Black audio film collective work.
Do we stay here?
How does it feel looking at this?
Yeah, well, strange.
Can I? I think all right. Obviously, Black Audio Film Collective. I mean, maybe audio film. Obviously, that always is a phrase that jumps out. I mean, there's there are two really engaging layers going on here. Other than the it's interesting seeing the rhetoric from that time period in theory, isn't it? But also, you know, there's a very sharp politics and there's a very intense beauty with the sound and the images. Can you remember the space?
I mean, it's so, you know, it's really strange to me, actually, how when you think about what passes for filmmaking at the moment, just how limiting the journey that people take to arrive at filmmaking currently is. You know, you go to film school, or you go to media studies group, or whatever. I mean, this was, what you were watching there is a tape slide piece, and it was one of about 10 that we did, that we did between 82 and 85. In fact, that's all we did. We, the collective was very keen to make interventions in the gallery, the art world, very keen to make an intervention in the experimental film world. But we had no equipment, and we certainly didn't have the desire to work in television. I mean, you know, it's a mystery to me now why and how it became such a big deal, but we can talk about that, you know, how TV became such a big deal, because we had absolutely no interest whatsoever going anywhere near TV. What we did have an interest in, I think, was to, most of us had studied, in some ways, filmmaking, in one form or another, you know. At the same time that I was going to John's classes, I lived quite close to an independent cinema in Chelsea called the Paris Pullman. It was like 10 minutes from where I lived. And I went there literally every week to see anything, you know, Godard, Pasolini, Tarkovsky, whatever, you know. And so by the time I arrived at Portsmouth to do sociology, I already knew most of what there was to know about the kind of canon, the art cinema canon. And I arrived in Portsmouth, and I was also attending a class run by Simon Field on filmmaking. And there he just showed experimental cinema, you know, Brakhage, Gidal, Maya Deren, you know. So I also knew kind of pretty much the canon for avant-garde films by the time we set up the collective. What we had no idea of, and this was a kind of shock in a way, was just how little there was in that world of that was related to race, or, you know, how few black auteurs, directors, filmmakers there were, and how few of these films dealt with, you know, quote-unquote racial issues. So the 4 years that we spent as the collective making these tape slides was really about trying to figure out why that was the case, what the baggage of cinema itself was, you know, because you'd sort of grow into this thing thinking, oh, well, it's this space of freedom and it's a means of self-expression. And of course, it is all of those things too, but it is an archive of a certain racialized way of narrativizing the world. And so we really wanted to understand what those mechanisms of racializations were, which is what led to the tape slides. And they were absolutely laborious. So each image that you saw there would be made up of maybe three or four elements. There'll be a reversal neg, basically a slide, and it would either have a gel that's cut from birthday cards which had writings on it or particular shapes that we liked. And every single one of those texts were letter setted. I mean, they were physically, you know, scratched onto the neg. And it just took forever. So Signs of Empire was, I think, 40 minutes long. It took like 9 months.
Wow.
You know, to make. So that I'm probably looking at it now thinking,
where did you find the images? Well, it's
interesting. Why the hell did you do that?
Well, it's rare because the labor isn't obvious in the way that things are now. No. You know, I mean, unless you really know what you're looking at. I mean, where did you well, source those images? And also, can you talk a little bit about the soundtrack?
The range of imagery was pretty much the archive of colonial imagery. I mean, we looked at National Geographic magazines or travel narratives from the 18th and 19th century, photographs, you know, from expeditions to colonies. I mean, all with the idea of trying to find a narrative, you know, like what they were actually about. I mean, what does a monument to Burton or Speke or any of these great explorers say? How are they framed and monumentalized, and what is that saying about the people who are invariably not there when these things are built, you know, the so-called natives who help them to navigate their way, quote unquote, through the colonies or through these adventures. So the range was diverse, and what kind of our attempt to try and hold this stuff together was through the work of Trevor Matheson, really, who was a sound designer. Just an amazing, amazing, amazing guy. I mean, one of the things we're always interested in was not so much sound, but noise. Mm. And this was the period of a kind of post-punk explosion. Talent both here and in Europe in general, bands and collectives were all doing the same thing. Test Department in this country, you know, 23 Skidoo, were doing roughly similar stuff. Basically, people who were interested in that space opened up by atonal music, Schoenberg and the Toy of Tone. You know, people who were interested in noise in that way. And Trevor was one of those guys who, the first day I met him, I knew he was weird. But I also knew he was interested. He was the first guy I met at art college. He was standing outside when I went to register for this avant-garde course. And he had a suit on, and he was just standing. And I thought, black guy with a suit at art college. Weird. And he was. He was very, very strange, because what he looked like was not what he was interested in at all. He was interested in really, really extreme noises. And so the 4 years early collective years was an attempt to try and harness those noises and sounds for narrative ends, pretty much. Mm. And the reason why we called it Black Audio Film Collective, again, was partly because at the time all four words were as important as each other, I mean, for us anyway. The notion of working collectively was absolutely central. We knew that. We had kind of worked out. I think that partly what happens with individual black filmmakers is that they get ambushed somewhere along the line because they're on their own, you know. And lots of us had gone through this experience of, I think you come out of college and you think, I want to work in the media, or I want to work in film, or I want to work in the art world. And you go off on your own to try and do that. In those days, and slowly you realize that your experiences of rejection are pretty much all the same. You know, people say, oh, well, this is such a shame you came today, you know. Yesterday there was, you know, the job. So the realization that you were all being given the same excuses, in a way, forced you together. We thought, well, you know, like, we're hearing the same stuff, so we might as well do it together. So the collective was important. The black was absolutely crucial. You know, this was a sort of punk gesture, you know, because the thing you were always told was to hide the most obvious thing about you, which was that you were black, you know. Don't say you're a black filmmaker. Say you're a filmmaker. You know, and yet it was clear that the reasons you weren't getting to be a black filmmaker was because you were black. So we're like, okay, fuck it. Just make it clear, you know, so nobody says, I'm so surprised. I didn't realize it was you.
Right, you know, right.
Like, we're a black film collective who work with noise. So that was important because you didn't. It never entered my head, and I don't think it entered anybody's either in the group, that we would ever have to sell ourselves to anybody. I mean, like, this really was a secessionist, refusenik gesture to just be over there doing our thing. I wasn't interested in, you know what I mean? We knew what the project was, and we knew we weren't going to get paid for it. We knew we weren't going to make quote-unquote money out of it. So, you know, occasionally I'd work as a costume designer's assistant or a production designer or, you know, on TV dramas. But the work was working in the collective, in our space in Dalston for 7-8 years. That was pretty much what we wanted to do.
Right.
And, of course, the film that sort of changed all of that was Hands Were Songs.
Right. Yeah, I was just going to say the transition. So, from a clear art world space into the big bad world of television. So if we look at the next clip.
This is
And I have two thoughts watching that. I mean, one is I remember, you know, I first saw this film, the first piece of your work I ever saw, in New York in the early 90s, and, you know, being an American and knowing American film and documentary and whatnot, I mean, it was just like, you're kidding me. It was a door that opened into what political documentary could be, because sort of things dealing with race and... race in particular, but politics in American cinema, it was a bunch of people talking. And, you know, when I'm watching this, I was thinking, how long are we going to go before we hear? You know, remembering, it's, you think this was on television. I mean, the idea that this was your breakthrough into television from 2011 seems, yeah. I mean, what happened? Where are we? But anyway, before we go there, can you set that, you know, when was that made and what was the motivation? And
Yeah, I mean, I'm hit by all sorts of thoughts, but I, just to provide a narrative that people can follow for a moment, the last clip was of a BBC crew interviewing an Asian businessman in the centre of Handsworth, and there's a guy, a black guy in a white T-shirt standing next to him with a mic. That's, in fact, our 416 mic that he's got there. His name's Don Shaw, and he was a friend who called us to say, look, something's kicked off. This was 85, September 85. Something's kicked off. You should come down here. Partly because he knew that we were already collecting material around the country on the theme of surveillance. You know, we were very kind of influenced by Foucault's ideas on discipline and punishment, blah, blah, blah. So we were already doing something called surplus underclass. It was about how black youth were becoming a kind of surplus underclass in a kind of post-industrial space of decline. So that was the project we were doing, and it was very much like the tape slides. It was there were a series of investigations, again with no real idea of it becoming something that might show, definitely not on television. So we went, and Heather from Birmingham Film and Video Workshop, who's sitting there, was one of the first places we went and got some equipment from them. I think it was a 16mm Claire. It must have been. The MPR we were talking about yesterday came from them, and we had a couple of cans of 16mm black and white, neg, I think. So we were just going to stay there for a day and then go back. And I remember saying to the rest, look, I think this is serious. I think there's something happening here, which is, in a way, the idea we've been trying to work on. You know. So we stayed, and we were there for 3 weeks and kept going to and fro. And slowly, it emerged. Finally, that we could do something about the riots, you know. But looking at it now, I you can also tell all the other range of interest that we had. I mean, for instance, the newspaper stuff, we shot all of that ourselves, is with the optical printers and contact printers at the London Filmmakers Co-op. I shot that police van sequence myself, you know. So it was a very artisanal, hands-on thing, which was much more about trying to make sure that we had something to say, that we were in control of. And I'm so glad that that's how we started, because in fact, Channel 4, through Alan Fountain, came in almost at the very end. Someone had told him that we were making this project in a way that most other independent collectives worked at the time. We were no different. You know, everybody I knew, be they Faction or Newsreel or, you know, Lucia Films, we all worked the same way. Everybody did the same thing. You know, you scraped stuff together and you made your shit. That was it, you know. He'd heard that we were doing this, so he came up. At the time, this was 85, we'd got some money from the GLC, so we'd bought some equipment. We had a six-plate Steinbeck that Monica over there used to cut on with me. And slowly, two people, a guy called Brand Thuman, who's still working as an editor, and a woman I haven't seen for a long time, who actually worked with me and Reese and Lena for about 6 months, Anna Liebchner, put it together for this guy from television, his weird world, to come and have a look. And he came, and we were really surprised, because one, he kind of got it. Like, damn, a fucker from TV who gets it. And he said, what are you going to do with it? And we were like, yeah, well, I mean, it's going to... I mean, we were not very cooperative. We were not very friendly, you know. We weren't interested. But he wore us down after a month of talking. And he said, look, you know, I think I've got a slot called 11th Hour. If you need money to finish this, I can give you some money and you can finish it. Mm. And that's how we ended up on television, kicking and screaming all the way. And it did. It transformed our practice in ways that were useful and good and ways that were not very good, I think, in retrospect. You know, because it shut off all sorts of avenues that we wanted to explore that we never really got to
right.
in the end. And those are part of the kind of historic compromises, as they were called then.
We've talked a bit in the past about how that decision to go into television was also sort of controversial in terms of the way other people around you responded to it. Can you talk a bit more about how your work was affected by that and how people saw it?
Well, the whole making images politically Godardian line, which was our mantra, essentially, suggested that working inside an organization, a mainstream organization, wasn't a good idea because we were going to get snuffed out. I mean, we didn't know enough to know otherwise, you know, because, of course, there are lots of people who had worked inside, even done some remarkable work from the get-go. But that's what we felt. We felt being inside was a bad idea. And I think what tipped us towards it. One was the discussions which were happening. And this is weird. I mean, just to go back a minute. I mean, I'd been part of the conversations about setting up Channel 4 at the IFA, right, in the early 80s. Or setting up the independent strand, because Channel 4 got going in 82. But it was never like something I felt we were going to work in. You know, this is just a political demand that there should be space inside television for different kinds of work without ever thinking that it was something that applied to us. And it was really another conversation that started to happen inside the IFA about something called a workshop declaration, which is this idea that Murray Martin in Amber, the collective in Newcastle, Mark Carlin in London, and a range of other people that started to cook up, which was a strategy that allowed the ACTT, the most closed of closed shops, to take on members who weren't from the traditional roots.
You know. What is what's the ACTT?
The ACTT was then the film union that became BECTU. Okay. Sorry, I should have said.
Sorry. Probably everyone else knows.
And the deal was that if you could get a certain amount of money together, if there were a group of you, socially owned outfit, you know, registered by the international industrial common ownership movement rules, if you were set up along those lines, then the ACTT would allow you to make stuff which could be shown on television, because that was partly why we weren't being shown on television, because we weren't members of the technical unions. And a number of black professionals, especially in television, were really against this because they felt that offering, you know, black media workers, this was a kind of ghettoizing, you know, strategy. But, you know, the thing is that precisely because it was a ghetto. We were very comfortable with it, you know. Those of us in the collective who wanted to be on the side. We didn't want to be in the middle. I didn't want to be in the mainstream, you know. We started to attend the union meetings, and Roy Lockett, the Deputy General Secretary of the Film Union at the time, was this remarkable guy who just kept saying, look, listen, I know you don't want to do this, right, because of the history of this union, but I promise you, if you guys do this together as a group, it will change the way the union worked. It will change your practice for the better, and you will be paid, and you'll get protection, job security, blah, blah, blah. And we were finally persuaded by that. And that's really what tipped it for me. That I thought, okay, well, this is a political demand being made by, you know, a union whose politics I agree with. You know, I come from a kind of communist family, so it didn't take that much to persuade me that going that route. And so we backed, as one of three black collectives, the idea of the union offering this workshop agreement to people, and joined and signed to that, I think, in 84, 85. So we were sort of ready to go into television when Alan came with the offer, because we were already kind of technicians, as it were. That's kind of how politically we got in. Aesthetically, I don't know. I mean, I think there was always a sense that a certain space in TV then was protected for experimental voices or voices from the edge. I mean, they had all kinds of phrases for describing who we were. And, you know, I'll say it again, we were very comfortable with that. You know, it wasn't like, I didn't see it as a marginal thing. I didn't see it as, you know, people say, oh yeah, but you're going to be shown at 11 o'clock. I'm like, who cares? You know, we want to be shown at 11 o'clock, partly because I never thought that that's all we would do with these films. And we never did. I mean, we showed on Channel 4, I think in 86 or 87. But between that, we'd self-distributed it, Handsworth, this is, opened it in six or seven cinemas in London. It did the regional film theatres. We took it to prisons, schools, film festivals. I mean, you know, that was part of what we believed should happen with black filmmaking, and that's what we did. You know.
And how much of that was, I mean, because these films, you know, from the, again, I mean, they take some work. I mean, they're beautiful and provocative, and they give you a lot of space to explore. But how much did you, I mean, you know, this is a film about riots. It starts with this ballroom dancing scenes. I mean, the meaning of the archive. When you go around showing it, do you feel like these films are about people finding their way through them? Do you feel like giving a narrative to go along with them is important? What's it like showing it?
I mean, I think the one thing we'd learned working principally in the kind of university of montage that the tape slides were for 4 years was that there were very different ways of putting stuff together. But with Handsworth, it was really a question of trying to work with the things that we knew. You know, I knew how to use a rostrum camera. I knew how to work an optical printer. It was relatively inexpensive. We could do that. The archival stuff, I'll talk about a little bit later on, but we always had a view on how to use archive, to do with all kinds of things that, again, I'll talk about later on. So, in a way, the whole approach of to making Handsworth songs, this bricolage approach, was about trying to draw the resources that we were comfortable in using, things we knew. That, I mean, I'd never used a track, you know, a kind of what's the word, a dolly. So, you know, it just didn't have things we didn't know. And that had a lot to do with some of the readings that we'd done over the years as well. I mean, one of the ideas that had a huge impact on us was an essay by the Cuban filmmaker and theorist, Julio García Espinosa, called Towards an Imperfect Cinema. And the notion of an imperfect cinema was precisely that. It was about trying to not allow the lack of resources to stop you from saying things you want to say. You know, it was about not allowing the lack of access to the glitter and the sheen of, you know, the latest technology to get in the way. And it was really about trying to also say that there's a way in which imperfections can sometimes be much more valuable because they're more revealing about where you're at. Mm-hmm. You know, tell people something about your conditions. Mm-hmm. You know, than that. So that was very central to the practice as well. I mean, we wanted something that reflected some of those theoretical concerns as well. It just felt right that that an emergent black aesthetic or workshop practice would draw on all the things it knew, but that would also draw on them with the range of expertise that it had at the time. That seemed as important ethically, aesthetically and culturally to us. Mm-hmm. You know, that the films revealed that they weren't done by anybody but us.
Right.
And this is what we could do. I mean, we were 20-somethings who had this level of expertise, so that's what you were getting. C'est ça.
So it's more than sort of a virtue of necessity. It's actually saying this is where we're... I mean, this is what we are producing because of where we are. And
yeah, I mean, don't forget, most of us... I mean, you know, I remember... We were sort of, when you saw that old Tory, John Lydon, on TV in 76, it was just this exhilarating moment. I'd known these guys because Don Letts had a shop on the King's Road, down the road from where I lived, and I used to pop there to work for him on Saturdays in 75, 6. And like all these guys who became the doyens of the punk movement would come in there, you know, Vicious, Lydon, Suzy Sue, all these people. And you could hear them as a kind of 15, 16-year-old talking about this DIY aesthetic, you know, just how you put things together. And, you know, so we were kind of... This was my familiar. I mean, I was very comfortable with the idea that you just worked with what you had and you did what you had to do because... You know, what you wanted to say was much more important than the means by which you said it.
Right.
You know, I mean, when you saw Lydon do Pretty Vacant, like, you thought, wow, fuck me, like, because I knew you couldn't sing, and yet it didn't matter. Like, on TV, he was completely transformed. You saw this guy standing there, the way he held the mic, and you thought, damn, you know, there was just this, you know, I can only describe it as. The kind of sense of power that people must have felt when they first saw Elvis perform or the Stones. That was our moment. We thought, like, wow. So you actually can do this. I mean, you can use the limits as advantage. And I don't think anybody of my generation, even if they weren't necessarily directly working through the punk aesthetic, ever forgot that. You know, like you saw something happen in front of you, which was... about people, working class kids, just saying, we can do this. We don't need the machinery, you know. And that was very much our philosophy and how we said it. You know? So sometimes you look at the things, that, and they're things that just makes you cringe. But you have to stand by those convictions that you had earlier, you know.
Mm-hmm.
One of the films that does make me cringe is the one I think you want to show now.
I was going to say yes. That's a great introduction. So we're going to show a clip from Testament next. So Hemsworth is it breaks you into television. It wins lots of awards. Again, I mean, it's a clear transforming moment.
Yes.
And then, well, I think we're leading through your themes quite well here. So we'll look at the clip and then talk about next, number three.
20 years ago, I started running from family and friends. I was trying to escape one day, 24th of February, 1966. 20 years ago, Abby was a student at the Nkrumah Ideological Institute. She's standing over a charcoal pot in a red brick kitchen. Machined, a friend and fellow student rushed in. There's been a coup. 5 words. I've been running ever since.
I can't not ask why it makes you cringe, although I hate to.
I mean, because it's so... the Testament was a major lesson, because I realized... I think up until then, I hadn't kind of quite realized how revealing of a certain emotional...
Yes.
Yeah, I just didn't realize. I didn't realize how much you could say without meaning to. Mm. You know, because the project was fairly... It started fairly simply. I mean, Handsworth was on that festival thing. Lena and David and I think Avril were in Berlin with it. I had gone to FESPACO, the African Film Festival. It was the first time I really kind of, you know, came across that world, the African film world. Met all the great directors in that world, Usman Semben, Haile Gerima, Met Honda, all these guys, you know. And I was there in 87 one night when I think it was either Semben or Lionel Ingakani, the South African, said, "Oh, look, isn't that boy a Ghanaian, meaning me?" And somebody said yes, and they said, "Bring him over." So they brought me to where they were sitting. They said, "Did you know that Werner Herzog is in your country?" "No." "Well, he's in your country, and we think you should go and try and make a film on." You know, there was this weird conversation between the veterans who met. They had this ritual every night of meeting by the pool at the Hotel Independence, having a chat about the world and how to fix it. And I think they decided that day that the fixing was me and Werner Herzog. And they were so persistent that they persuaded me that this was a good idea. So I came back. And you've got to remember, you know, we're a black British film collective. Nobody's expecting us to be going to Africa to do anything, you know. So I had to persuade the other members of the collective that this was something to do, and reluctantly, I think, because we were preparing what then became the third film, Twilight City, about London. Mm. At the time, spoke to Alan Fountain and said, "Look, I don't need production money, but I just need some funds to go to Ghana and try and do this thing." And when I first arrived in 87, the idea was that we would film Herzog doing his film on Bruce Chatwin's book, The Viceroy of Ouidah in Ghana, which is a fiction. So it's a fiction about a slave trader working there. And I just thought, this is fascinating. There's a fiction about this fictional figure, which is dealing with Ghanaian history. So we'll have that, and then we'll have the counterpoint of, you know, the recent Ghanaian history, the period between 49 when Nkrumah arrives in this country, and by 57 makes it the first kind of sub-Saharan country that's independent, leading up to the coup in 66 when he's overthrown. And but then it was illegal in Ghana to make a film about Nkrumah or the CPP. Mm. In fact, I'd only just been allowed into the country because my family weren't even supposed to be in the country. And so Verne's people were also saying, fuck off, we don't really want to do anything with you. Because, of course, they had Les Blanc's film about him, and they just felt they were going to be set up. And they were right, they were going to be set up. So they said no. And at a loss, really, as to what to do. You know, I sat down and wrote a 25-page outline, which is really my mother's story, of a woman who leaves after the coup in 66 to come to England, who returns, you know, 20 years afterwards to deal with the demons of that exile years, those exile years. And we got it made. Monica Enriquez, who's there, edited it with me, and my son was born that same year, so it was a very kind of complicated year for me. And I remember standing at Cannes, and he will probably not remember this, but Alex Graham, who's sitting, was one of the people who came up to me and said, John, why have you done this? They were really shocked that this group that had made Hands With Songs would go off and do this bit of Africana esoterica. But it was only when we finished it I realized what it was about. It was this kind of elegy to my mother's generation, and really the politics that had made me what I was in the first place. Because without that coup, we would never have ended up here. You know, I would never have been here. I would have been in some Soviet university, probably teaching Polish in Krakow by now, because that was what my parents believed. You know, if my mum told me that one, she said, you know, I think it's maybe just as well the coup happened, because your father was going to send you to the Soviet Union. I was like, oh God, to study Russian.
There's some good film out of the Soviet Union.
It makes me uncomfortable watching it. I couldn't stop crying all the way through editing it. And because I didn't understand why a film which was, you know, I knew it was about my mum in some weird sort of way, was inducing this, because she was fine. She was like, I mean, she's fine as you can be, you know, when you've lived through 25 years of exile. But it was only after a while that I realized it was actually about my dad, who died in that period. You know, he was a sort of unspoken, the unseen guest. And so it was very painful to make. It was very, very painful to watch. And I try not to watch it, even now. But, I mean, I learned something there, which I've tried to consciously work with, which is the idea that, you know, you have to be really clear about what you're trying to do, because sometimes what you're trying to do is not what you think you're doing, you know? Because what you think you're doing intellectually and emotionally sometimes are two very different things, you know? And I've tried since then to try and bring the two together so that there's at least some honesty for me when I'm working. That project literally just ambushed me because I didn't realize that the subtext was a kind of elegy for a lost love. You know, it never struck me that that's what we do.
That's astonishing, because when you watch the film, it's so, I guess that's what you're saying, it's so clear that that's...
Yes, but it wasn't to me.
Right.
It wasn't to me all the way through. I mean, I had pushed it so far away, because I didn't know him, he was dead when I was four. His death was the reason why we had to flee. My mother was afraid that she was going to lose her four boys, and so she takes off here. And this is a weird thing. Here's a woman who leaves this country to go and fight, quote-unquote, you know, for a kind of an anti-colonial struggle. And she leaves this country as a student saying, I'm never coming back because I'm going to be a new African, and, you know. And I don't know, 8 years afterwards, she's back knocking at the door. saying, can you please let me in, because them Africans are trying to kill me.
Right.
You know, and that's the other lesson that I've tried to work with, that there are these incredible ironic reversals in history, and ambiguities that are not, they don't fit simple narratives, or, you know, well, you're black, or yes, you're white, or, you know, you were African. You know, they're just ways of being that history forces on subjects that are not immediately apparent, at least not from the get-go, you know. And in the end, that's what I thought the film was about. You know, I thought it was just this intellectual proposition about the ironies of history, you know. But in fact, it turned out to both that and something else, which is this mournful, elegiac piece about a lost object, you know, subject, right?
Right. Is this the only... do you feel that there are personal stories from your life in your other films? Because, I mean, most of your work doesn't seem... It seems like you keep yours... You know, that at arm's length, and that's why this is a break. But do you feel it works its way in other places, or?
I think that everything since Testament, like I would always try and find a space inside it, which is, you know, just me, and that did cause problems. I mean, you know, you could tell. After maybe Twilight City, which is the film that I kind of supervised, I didn't direct, the third film, you could tell after that when the financiers or commission editors came, you know, to watch these films, you could tell when they'd fingered those pieces, because they'd always seem like, those pieces always seem like the bits that came from nowhere, you know. They would watch it. Alan Fountain, for instance, would watch it, and he'd say, "John, you know, that sequence, which is just music, and do you really need it?" they would always finger it. They would always go to that bit, which is the bit where, you know, you think, "Okay, now I'll get to speak for myself," you know. And so part of the initiation into making films for me has been an attempt to find ways of just spreading those affects across the film rather than just having it in sections. But in the beginning, yeah, we would go, okay, this is the bit where we speak to that group and that bit, and this is for us, you know. And you always felt like somebody was going to try and cut it out, and sometimes we did lose it because it didn't make any sense, you know. They were kind of longers or moments of dead time, or kind of, they just didn't fit. And in the end, you were persuaded by that. So the trick for me has now, since Testament, really been, okay, understand what it is you're trying to do, really. I mean, like, you know, do kind of just psychoanalyze yourself a little bit. Understand yourself principally first. And then try and work out what it is in you that these films are trying in some ways to express. Harness that, work with that, embrace that. It will normally cause you problems, but embrace that and try and make it kind of vaguely, you know, watchable, palatable, acceptable.
The John Akomfrah guide to being a successful filmmaker. Try to make it vaguely palatable.
Yes, because most of it isn't, frankly. You know, because most of it is by you talking to yourself, you know. And it's those bits of what most people would see as the ellipses of the pieces are usually the most private thoughts, musings, reflections on things that are, it's just, people just don't get it because they don't see what it is that you're reflecting on or musing on. That's really all, most of the time it is. They go like, what is this? And if you get a chance to explain what it is, then they'll go, yeah, okay, but maybe can you just say that?
Right.
So I try to learn how to, that's what I mean by making it palatable, just intelligible. Don't always succeed, but that's the aim of the time.
I think we're, as I predicted, talking a lot more than...
Than you thought, yeah.
Well, no, we're about... I was going to suggest we could either open to the floor now or we could show one more clip, just something... I thought it might not be bad to show something from, like, Last Angel, just because it's very different.
From
Well, we're sort of moving us in a different direction, or we could... open the floor.
Tracy or something.
Or do you, yeah?
Yeah, Shed Tracy.
Should we show one more clip and then we'll take... All right. So this is leaping ahead into... It's quite successful TV then.
Yes.
Well, not, you know.
Yes.
All right. So that is number 8.
It's weird because everything I've ever loved about making films is in that. One, because it's about the guy who I like a lot as a person, as a human being. I liked everything about him the minute I heard him 20 years ago. But it's also got the tinges of melancholia in it that draws me to stuff, because Jackie, his wife, died, woman in the film, died a year ago, Dick? A year ago. It was one of those spaces of freedom, because Mark Cooper at BBC Music had no money. He said, we've got the budget for a film to be made in-house, which I think was 50 grand then. And Lee and David and I sat down and we worked out that we weren't going to get paid. but we were happy to do it because he's just such a fabulous guy, you know. And it was a film about a guy who hadn't really had, I think, his just desserts in this country. So it's about what has kept us banging away with race for so long, you know. Trying to say something about the importance of the margins, really. And it was also a sort of major turning point for me, because at the end of that film I thought, you know what, I've kind of done this now with TV. I enjoyed it, but it's not where I want to spend most of my time anymore. I'll do it if there's something I'm interested in, but I'm not going to be doing the thing that we've done for 10 years, which is sort of chasing commissions and, you know, because, you know, you get to a moment and you think, how the hell did I get here? You know, like, here I am, I didn't even want to do this. Why am I chasing this? Like, it's not so, I never started off to do this, so why am I doing this? And I called Stan and we speak occasionally, and I always thank him for that, because it was just the freedom to do something that, because nobody was paying for, quote unquote,
right.
They just, you know, Mark just left us. He said, well, you know, just give us the film when you've finished.
Right.
So yes, it's in the language of television, but it was exactly how we would have done it if we had been paid. And I so enjoyed that process of not having someone come in, usually kind of 10 years younger than you, telling you, you know, you've got it all wrong, and, you know, this is really how you should do it, and if you just listen to me, then you get five more people watching it at 1:30 in the morning, you know, all of that. You just thought, you know what, I don't want to do this anymore. It's like tiring, you know. It's not just tiring, it's boring. I've done it for 10 years, you know. Which is not to say I have continued to do it, but at least I know now that there are other worlds, and I've just started to explore those more and more, and I'm the happier for it.
Well, that's good. That's an upbeat spin on it all. I think we better open the floor to questions. Are there any over here?
Hi. I was hoping to ask you a bit about your use of sound and how you choose a certain soundtrack to elicit an emotion or an idea in your works.
When I started, the default of independent filmmaking was no sound. Were very little music, and in fact most of our contemporaries hated what we did because it just had so much music in it and noises. But we wanted to sort of prove that it was possible to have another story, which is a non-visual story, happening, which is not gratuitous, because there's this kind of inherent suspicion in independent cinema that sound or music's gratuitous, you know, and I don't think it is. I don't think it is in principle, you know, excessive or gratuitous to use music. But there's always a story with the sound. Do you know what I mean? So, for instance, the Stan Tracy track that you heard, his voice is not great, but he's talking about the moment of his addiction to heroin and cocaine, and it was just so funny to me that the best jazz big score that he did, which is a fantasia you're hearing, was what he composed when he was completely off his head. Now, you know, he's telling you that it was a bad period in his life. He's telling you that he shouldn't have been doing it because he wasn't very happy. Yet the music is very, very beautiful. You know, so there's a way in which, for me, that piece there is absolutely indispensable in the storytelling. Without it, the story doesn't make any sense. It does, but it doesn't make the sense that I would like it to make. So I think that's the only thing that I would say is that I've always tried to find the storytelling potentialities, you know, in the use of sound and noise. And they don't have to be linear ones. Do you know what I mean? They don't even have to be story ones. They could be emotional ones. They could be visceral ones. You know, because people arrive at an acceptance of what you're trying to say by all kinds of means, not just you know, or here. They arrive at it sensually. You know, they arrive at it immersively. They, you know, that's kind of why we love the cinema. You know, I was doing a Dolby mix of the Nine Muses, the film we're going to show later on, at Pinewood about 6 months ago. I had this really interesting conversation with this guy, because I had tried to tone down all the sub bass stuff, you know, because I thought it was too much. And he said to me, "Oh no, we've got to have them, mate." He said, "You know, like, people need to be affected both there and there." And I thought, yeah, actually, that's what I've been trying to do all along. You know, you've just got to find different ways of telling a story, which is not just about the images. I love images. I can talk to death by images, but the sound is important. It's key. Yeah?
Over here, get a mic. The woman in blue.
Hi, John.
Hey,
just wondered if you could talk a little bit more about your use of newsreel footage, because it's very interesting how you use it and you kind of give it a whole new dimension, and you promised anyway you would talk about it.
Sorry, it was, the archival was one of the things I was going to get to. I'm afraid we didn't. I mean, one of the things I think we learned in the first 4 or 5 years of doing the, you know, archival research was something that's kind of become important, really, in all the work that I've done. You know, the Caribbean poet Derek Walcott, in one of his fantastic poems, made the point that, like all diasporic lives, black or any other, are characterized by a kind of absence of ruins. There are no monuments that attest to your existence, you know. And so in a weird and strange way, the archival is that monument. And this is the paradox of the archival, because on the one hand, when we first started to watch stuff, newsreels, you thought, oh God, you know, those voice of God bits, they were insane. And they are. They are both a kind of repository of official memory. But traces of your sojourn in this place. And so what we've tried to do, what I've certainly been very interested in doing, is interrogating those archival images so that they have both of those, so they both attest to the lives of people who weren't existing just to be troublemakers or, you know, kind of official statistics of unemployed black youth. Do you know what I mean? They're not just a problem. They're not just a social problem. They're human beings. They have their own, you know, specificity. So it's about trying to get that double move working in the archival material. And, you know, it's a bit that gets me into trouble more than anything, because people look at my stuff and they say, yeah, but you're getting those images to lie and they're not telling the truth. And I say, well, you know what? They never told the truth to start off with. they were partially true, but they, you know, they were true insofar as, you know, in 1962, you know, someone went to Birmingham to make a film about housing problems, and it just so happens that people living in that squat that he filmed were black until he filmed them, and they were kind of a social problem in that way. But there were more than that, even then. You know, there are people with dreams and ambitions and hopes, and, you know, so the idea is to try and open out the archival to say all those other things at the same time without denying that they were living in bad houses and were probably pickpockets. You know, I mean, it's like trying to say all of those things at the same time. It's an impossible task, but it's one that I think is ethically important for people like me to take on, you know, to try and suggest alternative readings of our past, you know. Sylvia.
In the back.
Thanks, Tom. Sylvia Harvey. John, I'm so pleased that you're here at the festival and that we're looking seriously at your work. I'm so pleased about that. But I want to ask you a question. It's partly about your work and partly about more general things. The festival is very plugged into the industry, extensively and systematically plugged into the industry. And I had a sense from what you were saying that your gesture in relationship to that is walking away. And I'd like to explore that a little bit more. The thing that strikes me is suddenly remembering Brecht in Hollywood, you know, Brecht when he was in exile, during the Second World War. And, of course, he thought perhaps he could work in Hollywood, and it turned out that really he couldn't. And then he was nearly nipped at the heels by the House Un-American Activities and so on. And where he went to next was the place that you didn't go to, namely the Soviet bloc, you know, not the Soviet Union, but Berlin. And in Berlin, I mean, communist-dominated Berlin, Cold War, Iron Curtain, East of the Iron Curtain, Berlin. He was able to do, I think, probably some extraordinary work in drama with the Berlin Ensemble. Now we're living in a very different world. I've just come from a session about the Arab Spring, you know, and the frontiers of democracy, extension of our, in other places in the world now. So I'm sorry it's a bit rambling, but I'd really like to know, is the main gesture a walking away gesture, or is there still a way in which it's possible to engage with at least some features of the industry in the West? I don't know what to call it now, because there's money and resources there, and I'd just like to know in a very general kind of way what you think about that now.
I mean, yes, it is walking away, but partly just facing reality. You know, I'm part of a very small group, a company, if you like. There are four or five of us. You know, we can't compete with the top dogs. We don't have the resources to compete with them to make, you know, cooking shows. I mean, so we're seceding from that treadmill because it just isn't worth, and we have done for a long time because it's just not worth our while. But in return, so rather than sitting in London, you know, mourning about not making daytime programs, I've been supervising films in Kenya where I've set up with Lena and David a 45-part series in Nigeria, a drama documentary, which is the first time that somebody, you know, Nigerian TV has done something like that. I've taken artist residencies, you know, I'm being in Egypt next month. You know, so there's a range of stuff that I wasn't doing before, which were part of the project, the original project, that just got left by the wayside as we chased this kind of thing, you know. I'm not that interested in it. I don't watch it that much. I know that's a standard middle-class gesture at the moment, but it happens to be true as well in my case. You know, it's not interesting for me. It's just not the place I want to spend, you know, the last and final act of my life. It's just, I'm not interested in it, you know, anymore. I just don't think it's interesting. I mean, I don't know why, other than the people make money out of it, anybody else is interested in it, frankly. But that's, you know, that's not a, and I'm not making a judgment on that. You know, I'm just saying that, you know, if you remember, Sylvia, at the IFA meetings, there were certain ambitions that, you know, we had for setting up the IFA and what we wanted it to achieve. Now, I don't think any of us, you know, you, me, Monica, can honestly say to ourselves that this is what we wanted. You know, and it's just honest to admit that. It's like, okay, job done. We got some of what we wanted. I mean, and some massive transformations, the democratizing of that space. You know, there are more, you know, people of color involved in working in it than before, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm not knocking it. It's fine. It's just not for me because it's not partly what I wanted. So I will chase the bits of it that I'm interested in, and the bits that I'm not, I'm just not going to sit around moaning or complaining. I've got things that I want to do, and I'm going to go and do those, and we have been. So, yes, the Berlin Ensemble is a very, very apt metaphor. I wish we can achieve half of what Brecht did in East Berlin. Yeah. Thank you for asking.
Question over here.
Hi, there, John. Sorry, I don't think this question will follow on very well from the last one because I know nothing about the film industry. But I was very inspired by what you were saying about the use of archives and its relationship to Handsworth songs. I work in Birmingham, and I also work with the archive with community projects. So I guess I wondered if I could just get you to reflect a bit more on the ways in which perhaps you see the kind of British urban experience being represented today, because it's obvious to me, working in Birmingham, the kind of legacy that a film like Handsworth Songs has had. You know, working with community groups, they know about it. You know, it's part of the kind of cultural landscape in that way. But I do sort of worry that there seems to be a bit of a space there for kind of really probing kind of representations of what's happening in places like Birmingham, not just Birmingham, but, you know, places that have all these really fluid kind of ranges of culture. And I kind of worry that, you know, an attempt to kind of address that really powerfully, you know, really strongly by using historical resources, the stuff you've got, a kind of DIY ethic, you know, those different layers of approach that I think you're talking through, you know, where that, how we can kind of facilitate more of that today, if that makes sense.
I mean, you know, I think, other than the DIY, you know, other than the sort of Jamie Reed manifesto, the other thing that I'm interested in re-engaging with again is something that kind of doesn't really happen very often in our discussions on the media. I mean, look, we're one of the few industries that hasn't embraced anything vaguely approaching a kind of eco-consciousness. You know, people shoot documentaries and they have 45 hours, and that 45 hours is then sort of boiled down to an hour, and then you've got 45 rows of tape or hard drives, and they just sit there, they do nothing. You know? And the next one is like somewhere else, because the emphasis is always on new, let's get, blah, 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 today we're going to China, and then, I'm really interested in connecting people to what one could only call a kind of recycling manifesto, forcing, you know, us and emerging talent to deal with the past in a much more creative way. Because let's face it, the idea that the Citizen Kane is going to appear on television, I don't think anybody believes that now. I don't think anyone believes there's some great big new thing that's about to happen. So why not just look back a bit? You know, why not just try and use this stuff a bit? Why not just be more green conscious? You know, it's a really wasteful industry. Everybody has it. You've got basements filled with tapes. Nobody ever goes back to them except to use just like snippets. So that's what I would say. I know that lots of, you know, the library, Birmingham Library, things, thousands of hours of audio tapes, or, you know, and I'm really interested in trying to work with younger filmmakers around this question of how one recycles former works in order to get them to say something new. We can talk later on if you like, because I'm coming down to Birmingham precisely to do something like this. And we can talk later.
I'm afraid we've
Run
out of time. What time is Nine Muses today? 12:40. So I hope that anyone who hasn't seen it will come see it. It's a beautiful film, and you'll see resonances of all the clips we've done. Thank you so much, John.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.